the last real big hit out before the games, and I want to get an edge over my competitors.
The level of windsurfer in RS6 class, it's really high and it's quite difficult to defend this title.
The competition here in Perth is top. There's no one missing from the world's best, and it's going to be an awesome race.
I think the spectators, you know, watching the 40 hours are going to see plenty of action. There's going to be big breeze, big waves.
It's going to be exciting, and anybody could win this event.
Beautiful Perth in Western Australia is playing host to the biggest international sailing regatta this year. 1,200 sailors from 79 nations competing in 800 boats. 10 world titles will be decided off the coast of Fremantle on 6 courses of this combined championship, one for each of the Olympic sailing classes. It's an impressive event that happens every 4 years, and sailors call it quite simply the world's. The top athletes is intense because this is the main qualifier for the Olympic regatta. All are here to pull out a top performance at the Perth 2011 ISAF Sailing World Championships. Five fleets have been racing here in week 2 of the championship, plus the women's match racing competition, which ends today. Our focus for this show coming up. Meanwhile, the 49ers are ploughing through an epic 15 race series until their medal race on Sunday. The Danes continue their fantastic form, with the top Nielsen brothers nailing race 9. But the surprise overall leaders are British duo Pink and Peacock.
Every race counts, kind of thing, because we only get one discard, so I think we're just going to kind of keep taking each race as it comes and see what Perth provides us in weather conditions and try and make the best of it.
Australia's Tom Slingsby has 5 wins from 8 races in the men's laser class, where a decent scrap is shaping up with second place Paul Goodison, the gold medalist from Beijing. In the women's 470, Spain's Pacheco and Betanzos stay at the top of the leaderboard, with Kondo and Tabata from Japan in second. Brazil's Robert Scheidt and Bruno Prada top the star class leaderboard after 8 races, with Americans Mendelblatt and Fatih in second. We'll have the big medal race final on tomorrow's show, plus the remaining 4 medal races on Sunday. A big day in sailing, which sees 4 new world champions crowned. And in the RSX men's class, Dorian van Rysselberghe is leading Poland's Piotr Miszka. The race teams on the harbour course set a new world record when they successfully started more than 400 races on the road to today's women's match racing final. 29 competitors sailed the round robin series, eliminators, quarter and semi-finals to get to today, and it comes down to just 4 teams racing for gold, silver and bronze. Claire Loire from France and Ekaterina Skudina from Russia both lost out in the close semi-finals, and they will face up today to race for the bronze medal. But the stars of yesterday came from the USA and the UK. Anna Tunnicliffe came all the way from the first weekend of the competition 2 weeks ago to win some memorable matches and her own semi-final 3-1. Britain's Lucy McGregor had an equally eventful road to the final, which was topped off by a comeback from 2 down in her semi-final to win 3-2. And that's put her into today's best of 7 showdown for the Women's Match Racing World Championship title. At the press conference last night, the finalists were all smiles, but winning a world title is a serious business.
I'm sure it'll be a very hard day. Anna and her team, very good they're good competitors as they've shown all week, and the conditions could again prove to be quite challenging.
We've raced each other a lot, and we know they're a very good team too, and it's going to be great racing. It's going to be challenging, and yeah, that river's tricky, and yeah, we're looking forward to sailing in it really.
Conditions are sparkling on competition day with sunshine and wind.
We've put a lot of hard work in. You've been training hard for our trials, and this is one of our top events this year, and to come away with the title would be amazing.
We had a great day yesterday. It was tough, but you know, I think the three of us showed that we'd really learned a lot this regatta, and we're sailing really well. We're confident with how we're sailing, so we're going to try and take that into today.
We're coming into the start, 2 seconds, one, starting. Okay, there we go, Richard.
That's the start there, or Tunnicliffe there. Did look a bit early. This is what happened. Tunnicliffe came up right by the committee boat, right-hand side. That is the American. Little late, McGregor was off. It's all going to be at about the first cross now. They're going to be sailing off literally as fast as they can into a drag race.
Here they go, the first tack. Lucy coming back. Will they cross?
McGregor has no right of way. Can she get past? If she can, she can't. Advantage Tunnicliffe. Is the boat in front far enough away to turn and pass ahead of the American? If she is, she will be first at the top mark in this world title. She isn't.
Whoa, that is really close. So this could be a penalty. She has not completed her tack there. Blue flag penalty, so that is Lucy McGregor has been penalised.
Well, let's just have a look at that one again, because that could be a game changer. So the boat leading had to cross in front of the American because they had no right of way to be there. If she was ahead, she was okay. But if she forced the American to change course, the British sailor would be penalised, and that's what happened.
I'm on the boat! Thanks, Nip.
Well, here in this situation, wow, that's a close jibe.
And, I was blue and boat. She had Lucy, tons of room.
Lucy's jived across. I mean, Lucy's
she'd say I was windward boat,
second
the American.
Way, second I
tried to move. What's this?
A second blue flag.
That's another penalty for the British boat. Well, they are shaping the course of this first match. McGregor on the left-hand side of picture is sailing past. Can she get the back of her boat ahead of the front of the American boat?
That's what she's going to try and do. Break the overlap first of all. Then once she's able to do that, she will then, all she can try and do is in fact unload the penalty by forcing a penalty onto her opposition.
It's all about can the back of the boat in front of McGregor's boat, if it's clear ahead of that number two at the front of the American, McGregor can go into attack mode.
You've got it spot on, Richard. This is looking really tight. And both of the teams know it. Everybody trying their hardest to break that overlap. She was very close then.
She can't attack until she's clear ahead of the American. But is she clear ahead of the American?
I think she's just done it.
No.
What are the options, Peter? What are the options?
The options are getting more and more desperate as every moment goes on, because Anna Tunnicliffe has right of way. Here she goes. She can dive in, going to go astern. This is going to get messy here.
So the British had to go behind because they hadn't got that overlap. Otherwise, there'd been another penalty.
Anna's very smoothly sailing down, about a boat length from the finish line now. I think there's no chance to get the penalty done. In fact, you see the yellow flag at the finish there. That's Anna Tunnicliffe takes the race, the first of the final in this for this gold medal in the World Championships.
And they're going to go into that cat-and-mouse scenario, aren't they?
Straight away into a circle for Anna Tunnicliffe, and Lucy weaving to keep clear. And this is really quite a strong controlling position for Lucy McGregor to get into. She's behind. Ooh, lovely move by Anna. There was contact possibly in there, so we might see. Here we go, yellow penalty. Lucy McGregor has scored one again, Richard. Well, here we go. You can see Anna jibing, trying to slow herself down. There she goes. Oh, a little touch right there with the bow, just amidships. And she was in the... Lucy McGregor is in the middle of the jibe. She knows straight away she's in the wrong.
Let's try and estimate the boat lengths. 5 or 6 needed for the penalty turn to be executed and McGregor to win this match. McGregor round the top mark for the last time. They've got a head downwind to the finish. She has to complete a penalty turn.
She's gone for it right away.
This is the moment. McGregor doing a penalty turn.
She's come out behind.
Well, Tunnicliffe went into this one 1-0 up. It was advantage USA. And then, before the start, it was looking like 2-0. Lucy McGregor made an error. It was a penalty. She did her penalty turns when she was leading this race. Great comeback, but in the end, there was an element of inevitability about it. The British sailor is sailing brilliantly, but is making a few mistakes, and those few mistakes are shaping the scoreline. Okay, that's the gold medal position. We're 2-0 up to the United States of America against Great Britain. Let's just go for the battle for bronze.
Now, this is the last big split coming into the finish line. They're trying to go for opposite ends of the start line. Looks to me like Claire's come back just in time to have a really into a safe position, and she goes across the finish line. The yellow flag's gone up there at the finish, so it's race over. I think that is 2-1 now to France.
Well, that's a battle for bronze medal position. We just joined that match in the final downwind stage. So the French won, so Claire Loire came out on the water today. It was 1-1. That is 2-1 to France. That is significant. The mindset on board both boats will change now, because the next match will decide, or could decide, if France are going to be on the podium tonight with a medal.
In race four of the pity finals, the Russians are just ahead on the final run to the finish.
Heading down towards the finish, and it is the Russian, close to camera there, who has the advantage just, but Claire Leroy won't be agreeing with that. The French sailor there, power on, big breeze, big gust. Advantage Leroy, heading down towards the finish.
And there was obviously a penalty call there. The green flag goes up from the umpire, so no foul. They continue on.
Going into this match, it was 2-1 to the French. If the French can cross the line first, bronze will go to France.
Well, they're right here, just outside the finish line. You can see the jibe coming now from the Russians and the French going to try and attack to get in there. This is going to be an extremely close finish.
Well, it's a hard one to call, but Leroy appears to have the advantage. The French team, there we are, the small stick, black and white. You could just see it. It is advantage France. France are heading, oh no. It's a photo finish, it's blue. We'll confirm that to you, because in the angle we had there, it was too close to call. We'll get confirmation of that. But that was a drag race down towards the finish. And Loire with the blue on the sail, it was a drag race that says advantage France.
Yep.
France will be on the podium tonight. France will win bronze. And Russia, will they push them all the way?
Look at her, she's pretty excited, Claire. Fantastic.
We make a great job. We didn't be so good during the freestyle, but the work of the team was really good, so we are really happy. It's incredible.
A good result there for the French crew. We'll be back in a moment for the deciding races of the women's match racing final. Do stay with us. Welcome back to Western Australia and the Perth 2011 ISAF Sailing World Championships, where 1,200 sailors are fighting it out for world title honours and Olympic selection. It's appropriate to see the new Women's World Champion of Match Racing decided here in Fremantle, because in 1987 this was the centre of the match racing universe during the epic Australian defence of the America's Cup. Director John Longley was on board the Australian boat.
Here was this event, you know, this ancient, prestigious event that was coming into basically this little town of Frio. And it changed it. You know, a huge party started, you know, restaurants came, it just blossomed. At the time we won it in 83, Australia was going through a bit of a recession. The place was a bit down. And suddenly, Australia had performed this amazing thing of beating the Americans at their own game. And it gave a huge fillip to the whole nation. If we can do that, we can do anything, you know? Stock market went up. It was just this amazing, euphoric experience. And I remember the day when, unfortunately, it's a very sad day, when Dennis Connor had won the cup back. People sort of poured into this place. They were 10 deep. It wasn't just at ground level, it was vertical. You know, they were crawling up the rigging of the prawn fishing boats and so forth. And it was an amazing atmosphere to be a part of.
In the background at the Maritime Museum of Western Australia, which is home now of Australia 2, that icon of Australian sport.
Behind me is Australia 2. She is the yacht that we took to Newport in 1983 and won the America's Cup. She's a 12-metre yacht, and she's quite unique in that she's the first boat that ever really had an upside-down keel and wings. And this absolutely drove the American defenders nuts because we hid the keel. They didn't know what they were racing, and the boat had enormously amazing performance because of it. I guess what is so fantastic about Perth 2011 is that this is our second go. You know, we brought the whole sailing world again. Admittedly, this time, a different section of sailing. This is Olympic sailing rather than big boat racing as the America's Cup was. But I know that most of these sailors who are here, a lot of them wouldn't have been born when we won. I know that sometime during the time, they will come here and make a pilgrimage to this very, very, very famous yacht. That made such an impact on the international sailing world.
Just joining us, this is all about who gets control in the pre-start. 2 minutes 36 till they're allowed to start. This is match racing, it doesn't matter. They can start as late as they like. It's all about being ahead of your opponent. United States of America 2, Great Britain 0, first of four, wins a world title. It's a split tack start. They're going to start in different parts of the start line. That is the start, and they were so close for most of the pre-start, and now they've gone to different sides of the racetrack. So the early stages of this match is going to be all about the shifts, which side gives the better shifts and the better angle towards the top mark. As soon as they go around this mark and the British team leads, or Tunnicliffe is close.
Got it.
Now the wind will hit the boat in second. First.
Got it.
Real opportunity now for Tunnicliffe to make her move.
Absolutely. All about the speed of this finicker set. And Lucy's and McGregor and team have done a fabulous set.
Great job, Heather.
And now this is going to be an interesting one as she goes up over the hip once again to try the whole attack routine again.
Yep. Can I leave the drive back?
Again, yeah, Anna, she'll leave this drive one more time. Lucy, delaying it is going to be a problem. She might get hauled again here.
Big hike. Hold it, hike.
Hold it, hike. That means that the American boat has got better breeze. On the right-hand side, look at the speed. Look at the amount of white from the front of the boat. That indicates the speed. Look to me as the Americans were going quicker.
Critical time, absolutely critical time right now. It looks to me like Anna has rolled Lucy's breeze here right now. So this is a reset. Anna is in front and clear ahead.
That picture tells a story. But in the last 300 metres, it's changed from absolutely game on 2-1 to... Peter Gilmore said it before this. It's backs to the wall. United States of America 3, Great Britain... They were trading tacks at the top mark. McGregor rounded first. Tunnicliffe was on the attack with the wind behind. We expected that. McGregor was defending well. Tunnicliffe made a move. McGregor made the error.
Wow.
Penalised. Was it going to be all on? Well, as Peter Gilmore so rightly said, absolutely. But actually, this time, we
were
running out of
racetrack. Sorry, I didn't mean to snap around that mark.
The penalty happened too close to the finish.
And
it really was one-sided.
Oh yeah, really frustrating that last race, especially when we had such a big lead at one point. But the conditions are so tricky, you know, and we just got gobbled up really in that second beat. And then we gutted about the penalty at the end because we just didn't think we'd broken at all, so we didn't think we were even taking any risk. So then to lose that race like that is, yeah, pretty frustrating.
Already Anna's up and going and sailing fast. It's now, there goes the start. It's now, where is the next puff of breeze?
And that is the start, and to me that looked like a good start for Tunnicliffe, because just before the line the wind went soft and light, the angle looked bad for the British team, and in 5 or 6 seconds it turned from potential neck and neck to surely advantage America. Let's find out if that is the case. The Americans have right of way, they're on starboard tack. This is match point for the World Championship, and they are going to pass ahead of the British team, and I think will tack because the breeze looks better for the boat on the left now.
Tunnicliffe led around the track and it was looking like game over until the very last stages of race four.
This is the finish. Tunnicliffe looks behind.
Coming up.
She's rolled her. She has rolled
her. Lucy McGregor has got past. The British sailor has overtaken. Well, within 120 metres of the finish, the Americans were on the verge of celebrating a world title.
Oh, my God. They got it.
Anna got through.
They got through.
amazing, Richard. Boy, oh, boy, that was the angle on the finish line there.
Oh, yeah. The American team at the last minute.
Oh, my God, it's amazing. Lucy is such a great competitor, and, you know, both teams came from so far behind at points to catch back up and make the races so close. Lucy was like, the girls did a great job with the wind out there. It was very tricky. And, wow, we did it.
Yeah, mixed. you know, gutted to lose that, especially the last one, you know, to end so close. But actually, we're really pleased with how we sailed this week, and we're not going to, you know, not going to forget that quickly.
Fleets race today. Out on the Star Class course, Brazilians Scheid and Prada scored a second and a third to leap ahead of the competition. The Stars are into the medal race tomorrow, and one team was over the moon to make that top 10 medal race cut.
Hey, monkey.
Canadians Richard Clark and Tyler Bjorn.
Now we had to finish top 10 to qualify ourselves to the Canadian spot for the Olympics. So yeah, to finish 10th is yeah, you know, made it as close as you'd ever want to make it.
In the 470 women's fleet, Spain's Tara Pacheco and Berta Betanzos are now 13 points clear of Japan's Ai Kondo and Wakako Tabata. Their medal race is on Sunday. And finally, those colourful Brits, Pink and Peacock, are now only 2 points clear in the 49ers. Australians Outeridge and Jensen are hard on their heels in second overall. It's certainly been a dramatic day here in Western Australia. One more world champion will be decided tomorrow, and four more in Sunday's grand finale. But for now, let's enjoy the moment when three sailors who dedicate their lives to success in this diverse and complex sport realise their dream of being the absolute best of the best in 2011.
Number one in the world, and that's how it feels. Anna Tunnicliffe, World Sailor of the Year, and today, World